It is good to have you back again. It's good to see you. What an exciting campus that we live on here, and get the privilege of being able to work together and see one another. Blessed days, warm weather, but still just blessed days. It is great to be alive, isn't it? We have much, much to be thankful for. We're going to be taking a look at a passage in 1 Corinthians today. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's the love chapter. And we're going to be looking at verses 4 through 13. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 13. I'm reading from the New Living Translation, and it reads this way. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless, but love will last forever. Now our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only part of the whole picture. But when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. But then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete. But then I will know everything completely, just as God now knows me completely. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. What a fantastic passage. We recognize those words, and we have heard those words countless times before, but it is always good to revisit them and to see what they say to us. Now, in the Ten Commandments, we find that there are some things that we are told to do and some things that we are told not to do. Yet they are all commandments, and we do not dispute them. In Luke chapter 10, verse 27, we find a core truth that says you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Today, we're going to learn about another passage that gives us some do's and don'ts. Sometimes it is easier to say what something is rather than what something is not. This passage that we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 gives such a command and instruction. Let's just consider just a few points today as we look at this passage. First of all, God's word tells us how to love. That passage that I quoted from Luke says we are to love with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. What is the heart? It's where we find our earthly affections. What is the soul? That is where we find our spiritual thirsting. What about our mind? That's where we find the forming of our desires. And all of our strength, that's where we find our will. All of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, our affections, our thirsting, our desires, and our will, those are to all be given to God. Those are the focus areas of our life. doesn't seem to leave anything lacking to me. What do you think? I don't think anything has changed. There is nothing there that makes us question or leave anything doubting. It is the full perspective of our life and every aspect of our life as we focus our full attention upon God. But God's Word tells us who to love. We're to love God supremely, obviously, with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, with all of those areas. But then Luke says, our neighbors as ourself. How much do we love ourselves? How well do we care for ourselves? What are those things that we focus on in our life? What are those things that keep our attention? What are those things that we recognize as needs? And if someone asked us what we needed, we would draw from those items. So if those are the things that we need, wouldn't it stand to reason that those are the same things that other people need? Therefore, if we love ourselves enough to look out for those needs in our own life, then we should also recognize that if we're loving our neighbors as ourselves, we should look to meet those needs in the lives of others as well. Now, we think that we understand what love is, who we are to love. But when we turn on the searchlight, let's see what we learn from this passage in 1 Corinthians. God's Word tells us what love is. Gives us a pretty good list there in verse 4, 6, and 7. It tells us love is patient. Love is kind. It rejoices with truth. It bears all things and it believes all things. That's what love does. That is how love manifests itself in our lives, by our patience, our kindness, living a life of truth, being able to bear up and understand and carry those burdens sometimes that are the burdens of someone else, and being able to believe and having a heart of faith, trusting in God in all things. It says that love hopes all things, endures all things, never fails. Love abides, and love is the greatest. Verses 7, 8, and 13. So you see the vast expanse of what love is? In every one of those areas, those are things that call out to us for a well-rounded, focused life that is being lived through the character and the expression of the purest of love. Quite a large task. Pretty high bar is set for us, isn't it? To understand what love is. Now, as I told you, sometimes it is easier to recognize what something is not rather than what it is. Well, it just so happens that this passage in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, also tells us what love is not. Again, we look at verse 4, 5, and 6. Love is not jealous, doesn't brag, it isn't arrogant, it does not act unbecomingly, it does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account a wrong that has been suffered, and it does not rejoice in unrighteousness. Those are the things that love is not. That's what love is not. So now that we know what love is, what love is not, then we have to kind of turn our focus onto something and realize that love should govern our lives. If it tells us what to do and what not to do, and that is the motivation of our life, then we need to recognize that love needs to be the governing nature or the governing power in our life. You see, that same love that tells me that I have to give you the benefit of the doubt in regards to your behavior speaks to me, speaks to each of us. That same love that I've been told to give you the benefit of the doubt, it is the same love that should guide you to a better behavior in yourself. We can recognize and love one another, love someone else. But until we recognize that love also guides our own behavior, how we look at things, how we interact, how we react, our relationships with people and with God. So if that's true, then we must understand and accept God's word as the guide for our lives, even when we do not like what it has to say. Now, there's been a lot of times in the course of my walk with God that God's word has spoken to me and I really didn't like what it had to say, but it spoke to my heart and I had to make a decision. Am I going to follow the word of God or am I going to be selfish and self-willed and defiant? Even when it points an accusing finger at us, we still need to recognize that God's word is the guide for our life. When we are shown what is wrong in our lives, it becomes our responsibility to change or not to change. If we change and accept the correction that God is offering to us, we are at peace and growing in the Lord. But if we do not change and we ignore the instruction of God, then we stand guilty and will remain so until our life and our attitudes change. Until that is surrendered to God, we shall remain trapped and standing in guilt. Could be the possibility of eternity. If our lives end with such an attitude and lifestyle, God's word speaks to us today. This 13th chapter of Corinthians, of 1 Corinthians, it's a powerful passage and it's a cornerstone. It is actually called the love chapter out of all of the passages in the Bible. That has been recognized through the ages as the love chapter. That being the case, and the fact that we have now received instruction, we know what love is, we know what love is not, we know that God instructs us, speaks to us, draws us closer to Him, then what shall be the guide for our lives? We are in a position of making a decision. What is it that is going to guide our life? Is it going to be ourself or is it going to be love? If we choose love, then it is the love for God and for our fellow humanity. That's what moves in our life. That's what guides our life. In everything that we say and do, to be able to do it all out of love for God and our love for others. Love is an amazing thing. It's not just a catchword. So many young people think that they know what love is. We could debate all day long the difference between love and affection, between love and desire, between pure love and selfish love. We could go in a lot of different directions. But we're going to allow this passage to speak for itself. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 13 over and over and over again. See where it takes your mind. See where it takes your heart. And see where it takes your life. Amen. Let's pray together. Creator God, we ask you to bless our Westminster community and all who live and work within it. May this place be filled with deep caring, welcoming hospitality, and dedicated respect. May all who visit here be greeted with warmth and kindness. May all who live here be graced with God and peace. May all who serve here do so in the spirit of Jesus, whose deep love and dedication to healing touched all he encountered. Amen. May God bless you, and may he use you to be the bright spot in someone's life this week. Amen. See you.